Hi folks, this is David Kwan here. I realize it's now 2015, but I did write this one blog on my WordPress blog site on the first day of January, and I actually intended to not only write it, but to just kind of read it and do a vlog, a video form too as well, but I never got around to doing that. So even though we're now, 19 days into 2015, I still want to just talk about 2014. I made a video in which I talked about my 2014, and that was a personal video. But I thought, you know, there's still a way to talk about 2014 that is less personal but still personal. And talking about kind of what happened around the world in this country, but you know, from the perspective of someone who's living in New York, somebody who's who learned about the world through American media and things like that. So this was the kind of the blog that I've written, just kind of reflecting on 2014. I like reflecting a lot. I guess as a high school student, my favorite subject was history, and that part of me I think still carries on to this day. But anyway, this is kind of what I've written. I'm not gonna read everything word for word, but I'm gonna kind of use it as a baseline here. But this is how I begin it. Like any year, a lot of history happened in the year 2014. For most of it, I was in my own personal bubble in my apartment in Brooklyn in New York. It was within this bubble that I came to learn what happened around me, and which was filtered by American media, Twitter feeds of people and organizations that I follow, Facebook algorithms that kind of decides the stream, and it also it also includes the stuff from organizations, friends, former coworkers, colleagues, strangers I came in contact with, whatever. This is kind of how the news comes to me. So it's how reliable and how accurate is that, I can't really say, but that's kind of my perspective grows from that, and I can't quite put my finger down on what the year was actually like. I can't judge it like 2014 was an awful year or 2014 was a great year. I mean, there are so many instances. History doesn't happen that way. It's not like, sometimes when we look back at history, it's like, just 1776 was the year. We do tend to have like a kind of a value judgment on the years and things like that. But when you're right there in the year, and the year is right before, just barely 2015, it's kind of harder to do like a value judgment on one year. When the year is just the previous year. So I don't really have a decisive adjective to describe 2014. But I do think that it's really important to just kind of think back a bit of it and remember the historic moments of 2014, and historic according to the perspective that I have, And in my memory, 2014 began really cold. I remember beginning a day inside a high school auditorium because I was an intern at a high school. And I noticed that half of all the students and the teachers as well were not in the auditorium that we meet at every morning. So that was February 28, 2014, which is now recorded in history as a day, as like the coldest day in New York City since 1871. It's the coldest day in New York City in 100-year history. And it was a continuing story of New York City having really bizarre temperature swings. In 2011, there was Hurricane Irene, and in 2013, there was this crazy Hurricane Sandy that happened. So, New York City is a continuing story. It's a trend that's been happening, and 2014 was a part of that trend. And I write in here, I really don't want to assume there will be another chapter to the story in 2015. I hope not. But the temperature of New York City being so wild is an interesting topic. But, on a related note, on September 21st, 2014, over 300,000 people marched along the streets of New York City, through Central Park, through Wall Street, and really chanting and demanding action on climate change. There was this huge rally march. It was the largest climate change march in history, and the date of the march was planned to coincide with the date of the UN summit on that topic. What I felt soon after this day was this really idealistic notion that people were coming to be more and more aware and concerned about our human impact on the environment. Despite this important issue being so repeatedly and continuously dismissed and ignored by corporate news and networks and think tanks. Because, you know, this event was a huge historic event, but who covered it? Not many places covered this, you know, humongous climate change march, which is interesting. In 2014, people marched and protested a lot, but that's not specific. That's not unique to 2014. And in 2014, there are a lot of the many marches and rallies and protests. One thing that, like, I guess people talked a lot about was regarding Ferguson, Missouri, in which, you know, the Missouri grand jury decided not to indict Darren Wilson, the police officer who shot and killed Michael Brown. This became a national conversation in the country for months, sparking debates and discussions on topics of anti-black racism in America, and all these other topics too, like militarization of police, criminalization of poverty, police brutality, especially towards disproportionately darker-skinned black and Latino Americans, about the U.S. criminal justice system, and other topics that are really related to those kind of things. Conversations started happening, some of them not necessarily conversations, but, you know, at one point, I almost felt like there would be kind of maybe even a movement toward nationwide rioting. I mean, it was a wrong assumption, you know, wrong thought on my part, but that's kind of the, you know, so many piling up the national conversation that happened, and it really intensified with the grand jury of not indicting Officer Daniel Pantello in New York City because, you know, he ultimately choked and killed Eric Garner. I said his last name really weirdly, Eric Garner. So, you know, after that, there were several movements that kind of responded to this event. There's the hashtag Black Lives Matter, hashtag All Lives Matter, you know, hashtag I Can't Breathe, hashtag Blue Lives Matter, which is about the, you know, support for the NYPD. So all these kind of things happened, and it kind of really kind of blew up. It was a brewing of tensions between NYPD and Mayor de Blasio, and that really kind of really brew at the end of the year in December. So it was really interesting. But, you know, the protests and rallies about anti-black racism or police brutality or the opposite of you know, whatever, the opposite, you know, it wasn't the only thing that was being talked about that was a large movement in 2014. Another large movement was around minimum wage. Most were local movements, you know, like, but there were notably large movements by workers in Walmart and workers in fast food restaurant. Fast food restaurant workers actually struck. They conducted a strike across America at one point in 2014. So it didn't really erupt into a crazy full-blown class warfare or anything like that. And the history of American society is actually full of them. If you read about the years right immediately after the Civil War in the 1870s and 1880s, and in the 1890s especially, there was, you know, Howard Zinn in his book, People's History of the United States, there's this chapter, he says, the chapter title is very, you know, the Civil War. I think that's chapter 9. And then chapter 10 is the other Civil War. So I think that's it's a very powerful title because it makes you think, like, wait, what other Civil War are you talking about? And it actually happens around the time of the Civil War, but that other Civil War is about poor Americans versus rich Americans. There actually was a pretty crazy and bloody and violent kind of warfare between the have-nots and the haves in America 100 years ago. So when people, you know, talk about, like, you know, all this looting and protesting, oh my God, so awful and bloody violent, they should study American history a bit more and kind of put that into context and compare. Not to say that, you know, that's not to excuse any violence, but that's just saying, for comparison's sake, there was at one point in which 100,000, I don't know why I'm talking about 1890s when I'm really supposed to be talking about 2014, but, you know, there was at a time when the National Guard was called and 5,000 American soldiers and reserve duty officers had to fight a war against, like, 100,000 middle-class Americans and working-class Americans and many people were many people died, many people got injured. It was a battle. It wasn't a protest. You know, it wasn't just looting. It was actual gunfire battle. Anyway, so that, you know, that was kind of one of the large movements in blah, blah, blah. Well, and to me, what the comment that I made on one of my Facebook posts was, it's a very interesting time because homelessness in New York City is rising and rising and rising. Homelessness in New York City has never been this much of an issue. Like, it's always been an issue, but there has never been this many homeless people in New York City. We now have close to 60,000 at this point, homeless people. But at the same time, the contrast is we never had this many billionaires in New York City. It's a huge contrast. Historically, ever in history, there has never been this many billionaires in New York City. And not only that, these billionaires have never been this richer. They're the richest they've ever been. This huge inequality. You know, there has never been this many homeless people in New York City, but at the same time, there's never been this many billionaires in New York City. You know, and the thing I ended up, I made this a Facebook update, and I was like, the last thing I said, the sentence that was kind of very, you know, kind of stirring the pot a little bit, was, I don't think these two facts are unrelated. And I kind of left it at that. 2014, Obamacare was still the law of the land, though its future now really hangs quite uncertainly in balance. You know, 2014 in Congress was a year of gridlock at a federal level. Almost no laws were passed, and politicians spent more time filibustering and bickering over party lines than promoting for the general good of the American public. This might just drastically change starting in 2015, and I think we're already actually starting to see some of the drastic change now, this early in January, and that's because of the November midterm election results in 2014. Entire Congress, both the House of Representatives and the Senate, is now Republican-controlled. Or, I don't really like saying party-controlled. I usually like more saying party-dominated. This is predominantly certain kinds of people. A lot more Republicans now. So, in a few issues, in fact, in a very few issues, the Congress is actually veto-proof. So that's pretty crazy. So. And also, for me personally, this was the first election ever, American election or any other election, I was actually a part of. I voted because I became a U.S. citizen in 2014. So I was able to exercise my right as a U.S. citizen in 2014. So for me, that makes it a particularly important year. But even contrast that with the rest of the country, political participation in America in 2014 was abysmal. Majority of people did not vote. It was a tiny minority of people who actually voted in this country. So that was interesting. You know, personally for me, most people in my age group, you know, I'm 27, most people in my age group did not vote. So Democratic participation in America in 2014 was just really, really bad. But on the other side of the world, 2014 is a historic year. The largest election in world history happened in 2014 in Indonesia. I forget the number of people who voted, but election took place in Indonesia, and it was like 80% participation rate in the country. Indonesia is a huge, huge country. So, you know, no time in history has so many people participated in a democratic election. So that was an incredible historic moment. Not many people know about this. I probably would not have known about it if I wasn't watching The Daily Show, which is so surprising. Almost no news media, no news channels, hardly any cover the fact that there was a historic election that happened this year or past year. I feel like only two places actually talked about the Indonesian, or three places, Indonesian elections, but two actually are pretty much one. Comedy Central, Daily Show, and The Colbert Report, I pretty much count as one. You know, they talked about it briefly. That's how I learned about it. They talked about how others were not talking about it. And the other place was Democracy Now. Amy Goodman had guests on the place and talked a lot about it. So only two places actually covered this incredible event. that made 2014 what I think makes, you know, at least on the global scale. Americans didn't care, didn't know, whatever. Also in 2014, something that happened in regards to Obamacare, Vermont was a state that was kind of on its path to a single-payer universal healthcare system. But in December, the last month of 2014, the governor of Vermont said it would cost the state too much money. It would cost $3 million or something like that. Pretty a modest amount, actually, considering. But, you know, so it's not happening. So, you know, that just means I wrote that in the blog, healthcare in America will continue to be a serious issue in 2015. And then, also another thing that happened in 2014 was this whole hysteria about Ebola. Many TB pundits were terrified by it. They demanded all air travel to African countries be arbitrarily disabled. There was a huge hysteria about Ebola. And unfortunately, you know, I was really disappointed the cause of the hysteria. Not necessarily the story itself, but like why people were you know, so terrified. It was not really, the reason wasn't because Americans were becoming more aware and more informed about what was happening, the Ebola epidemic crisis in West African countries like Sierra Leone and Liberia, Nigeria, whatnot. No, it was nothing like that. It was actually because there were a few people, there were two people who came, who served their time, you know, they volunteered and they really with Doctors Without Borders and organizations like that, and the Medicines Du Monde, Doctors of the World, went to these different types of countries and they treated patients with Ebola and you know, assisted families who had family members who were surviving Ebola. Whatever, they returned, like three in total. I think there was one nurse too, one in Texas, and two people in New York. They had Ebola, and the country freaked out. Really, just the how they freaked out and why they freaked out was a very disappointing thing to see as an American. Another international topic, hot topic in 2014, and it's still an issue, was this nation-building terrorist group. They were initially dubbed, and then some of them still call them this, you know, Islamic State of Iraq and Greater Syria, or ISIS for short. I personally like the president. Obama's administration. I don't like to use the term ISIS. I like to use the acronym ISIL because, well, first of all, the name is an English name that we created. The actual name is in Arabic, so it's not technically ISIS. But also, the thing is, ISIS is the same term as the name of an Egyptian god. And there are many people living in American citizens who are named after the Egyptian god, so they're almost vilified. And there are companies and organizations that are named ISIS, not I capital I S I, but capital I with lowercase, you know, S I ISIS, whatever. And that kind of unintended consequences, I think, is concerning. So you know, I'd rather say ISIL when I talk about it, or just saying this terrorist group. Islamic State, calling themselves Islamic State is also interesting, but they're well, ISIL as a topic overall is a whole different topic. But that was a huge, big topic in 2014, and everyone had very scattered opinion about ISIL. But although the unifying opinion is that they're just a horrific, awful group that it pretty much made America return. U.S. armed forces pretty much return to Iraq. Although we technically left, we never left. You know, that's kind of what's happening with Afghanistan. So at the very end of the year, and I'll end this video with talking about Afghanistan. For over 10 years, the operation in Afghanistan has always been referred to as Operation Enduring Freedom. But now, at the end of the year, the mission. The operation name has changed, and the Obama administration decided that it's now going to be called Operation Resolute Support, because you know the U.S. Armed Forces soldiers are leaving, but a lot of military advisors are still going to remain to train Afghanistan soldiers, to advise Afghanistan military commanders, to assist the remaining infrastructure and kind of the system in Afghanistan. So, you know, it's still like, we did our thing, but we're not actually ending, kind of, you know, still. So that's kind of, it's a very complicated picture, I think, the picture of America and the counterterrorism in the outside world, very complicated picture. And I haven't even talked much about, like, you know, drug war and war against drugs and whatnot, which was actually not a big topic in 2014. Not much time was spent in the press about war on drugs, and I don't think many people that I know, I personally haven't either, talked about it much. So it's kind of like almost no year, but you know, but that's what I want to kind of, man, it's already a 21 minute video, and there's so many other things that happened in 2014 that I have not, was not able to talk about here. And so at the very last paragraph of my blog, I kind of list them out. You know, there are so many other things I want to talk about. You know, there's the Hobby Lobby case, which extended corporate personhood in a way that includes now religious freedom, which is another, you know, there are all these things that it can be a separate video topic, you know, and people have made separate video topics. The idea of talking about this all in one video on blog was kind of a, there was Gamergate, and I recently just talked to my friend about it online, and it's going to be posted on his YouTube channel, so that's going to be interesting, the discussion that we have. There was the Ice Bucket Challenge. Malala Yousafzai was finally awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. And there was, at the very end of the year, there was the worst cyber attack in world history, which, you know, was the attack on Sony, and whatever. So that I think, kind of is my summary of 2014 in a nutshell, the kind of things that happened in 2014 to me that I felt were historic. Of course, there are a lot of things I was not able to talk about, and that are probably as historic or more historic than the things that I talked about. But I think that just talking about these kind of things is in a way to kind of reflect on the year that we had as we keep moving forward and start thinking about the world that is happening around us and the lives that we lead in this world, in this society, and how all these things are fed to us, you know, like the manner in which stories are covered. The manner in which stories are told to us, I think it's very important that it's very hard to overlook or to not realize, because to realize what's going on requires that we are also aware of what they're not telling us, and that's super hard. Like the fact the Indonesian election was not being covered was a huge kind of thing it's a very difficult thing, I think. It's almost impossible. Like, how would I have not known about that if the Daily Show didn't cover it? If America Now, if Democracy Now was the only place in which you could find out there was this humongous election in the other side of the world, I don't know. And that really poses the importance of a site like an organization, an independent news site that doesn't accept any donation from corporations or foundations. You know, how do they make money? I don't, you know, it's from donations from people like us, but it's just, even that concept is still so hard to understand. Also, they're a really small organization. You know, a media site like CNN is gigantic. But they can't cover stories that their corporate backers don't want them to, because otherwise they'd lose funding. You know, it's a very, you know, man, okay, that's pretty much this video. I'm just me reflecting back on 2014 and digressing to a whole bunch of other topics. But anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed. Share your thoughts about, you know, what 2014 was like, not only for you, but what you think was like for, you know, the world around you, your city, your country, the world. Yeah, so cheers.